Hello, welcome to our second webinar in the Power for Bio series Food and Feed. I'm Marieke Bruins, I work at Wageningen Research, and I will give you some technical examples, food related, for added value generation. So these are examples where people develop new products, mainly in the oils part or on proteins, where they wanted to create additional value next to their main products that they already had. And this is in contrast to examples on sustainabilities that I will talk about next time in webinar 3. So how can you add value to your process? In general, there are two routes to do this. You can try to reduce the cost price. And this can be done, for instance, by cheaper sourcing. Cheaper sourcing of biomass, for instance, from side streams like agricultural side streams or food residues. And then an additional advantage is the reduction of waste. Or you can try to find a new application for one of your side streams or products with a higher value than its current value. And a good example of that is what's happening now a lot is that people with feed products try to find a food application for their product by further refining it, for instance. Also, if you can make a healthier product, you can earn more money. So, towards what can you valorize food processing side streams or agricultural side streams? You can think about feed, and then it represents sort of the lowest value. You can think about food ingredients. This is a really nice example because extracts or other compounds can be really valuable. However, they are often sold in low quantities. And you can think of bio-based applications like chemicals or materials. To the right-hand side, I have sort of a generic picture of from gutter to good or from gutter to gold. Later on in my presentation, I will reveal which product this is about. But it's a product that was previously disposed and from which people are now making a lot of money. And it can be an example on how to improve your value. We will start the examples with some examples on oil. Because oil is already a product in many cases, you can get oil from soybean, from rapeseed, from palm, and also the side stream there, the press cake, is already a product. They found a common solution for that. All these press cakes are very rich in proteins, and they are sold as feed. There's a huge feed demand, especially in Europe. We have a very large livestock production, and we don't have all the fields to deal with that. The nutritional value of all these press cakes is relatively good for feed. It has a complete amino acid profile, and that's especially true for soybean proteins. And then it has an attractive cost price because you already make money from selling the oil. The press cakes are not that expensive. So the economic value is good. The success conditions are, of course, that a very large volume is available. The economy of scale for these type of processes is really good. You can even ship it across the ocean for that. It's a commodity market. It has a direct link to the local market. And as I said before, it's a cheap protein source, which is nice for farmers. There were and are still some hurdles. For instance, in some of the cakes, there are anti-nutritional factors, for instance, in rapeseed. And they limit the dosage that you can add to your feed. Currently, a lot of research is being done about that. And for a lot of press cakes, it's already solved because, for instance, soy press cakes, the soybeans are toasted before they are pressed. But there can be potential follow-up steps. If you want to move into even more value, you would like to sell as food, of course. And for that, it might be useful to further separate the protein from the still remaining fiber fraction that's in the press cake. This is not economically feasible for animal feed, but it might be for food if you then have a very nice protein. And DSM is, for instance, developing this for rapeseed press cake. And then you can upgrade, you can apply it in food instead of feed. Currently, it's not being done, and you also don't know what the consumer appreciation will be, but you need to develop new products to see what happens. Also, the efficiency of protein extraction is not yet up to speed. You can either have a high purity or a high efficiency, but never both. So that also still requires optimization. But in general, this is a side stream that is being valorized and can even be better valorized in the near future. Another process that makes money from both oil and proteins is the valorization of residues from fish processing. This is especially true for high-fat fish, where they have a rendering process that is current practice, and there they obtain a high-value fish oil, and they have the proteins from it, which are an ingredient for fish and animal feeds. This business case is quite okay, but if you have lean fish, which have a low oil yield because they don't contain too much oil, then the business case doesn't fly yet. The current use of these residues is often bioenergy, and that's a very low value application. So it would be nice to develop an alternative valorization chain for those type of fishes that aims more at the protein part and develops mild separation processes for high quality protein. A very nice driver for that might be the high price of fish protein and fish protein hydrolysates. Also, there are significant volumes available of this starting material, so that would aid in its success. And if you process fish residues, they might be more stable than the current case where the fish is aimed, for instance, for feed meal. It hasn't happened yet, and there are still some challenges, like investing in a process. Also, the application is not there yet, so you need to develop a whole new market for a protein product from this process. A third example that I would like to give on combined protein and, in this case, fat production is the gelatin process from Tenkate and Gelita. There used to be at Tenkate a very high temperature fat rendering process, and this high temperature gave rise to a high fat yield. And if you only make money from fat, that's the way to go. But it also yielded a low quality protein fraction, which was denatured. And if you take into account a minor loss in your fat recovery, but a better quality protein, you could end up with a much better process, and that is actually what they did. They designed a whole new process, which is an innovative process only built on mild separation, so they avoid the use of high temperature, and they get even a better quality fat than they got before, and they got good quality proteins. They have two types of proteins, an insoluble protein part and a gelatin part. And then this, the reason that this was successful at a certain point of time was that the gelatin from pigs actually became a very nice alternative to the gelatin from ruminants. And that was because of the BSI crisis. At that point of time, we didn't want any ruminant products anymore. Another important factor here was that there was an eager entrepreneur that wanted to make this a success. And I think in general, this is a very, very important point to have. They patented the mild extraction process and there was a market demand. This was actually quite a nice example of how you could develop new processes. Another example that I show you, because it has a different success condition than the previous ones, is the production of avocado oil from reject fruit. The driver is very obvious. There is a large volume of reject avocados in some areas, and farmers would like to make money from that. So what to do with it? People developed new processes for that, and they found out that the avocado oil processing can be done on olive oil equipment. And that's really nice. That is an additional reason for success, because the equipment for the olive oil extraction was already available and the avocados come in a different season. So there's complementary in seasonality. The rest you just keep the same, so you use the same distribution channel and you have the same type of market. You still need to look at the quality, because not all avocados are equally suitable for this. And then one last topic on oil, without proteins this time. It's the company Peel Pioneers. They found a solution for citrus peels. Of course, there's a common solution for citrus peels, and that is to create oil and feed from it. They press the peels and the remainder is used as a feed, and that already creates a market. The nutritional value is okay for feed, and the oil makes money. So for this, there's already a large volume and a commodity market available. But the disadvantage is the drying cost of the peels and of the product. The Peel Pioneers created another process which creates more value, as it creates more products, and they are created at a higher value. So next to the citrus oil, they, for instance, extract limonene, which can be used as a detergent, and they create fibers from the remaining cake. These dietary fibers can be created with or without the flavor of the citrus, and then they can be used, for instance, for meat substitutes if they don't have this flavor, and in bakery if they do. So that's really nice. They created multiple outputs and make more money with the same material. And especially the technical functionality that they created gave them a market. They partnered with suppliers and with end users, and in that way they became very successful. For this example, I've turned off my camera, otherwise you will miss out on a nice picture. It's an example on mango stones in Africa, and I show this specifically because it relates to the avocado rejects, as it has a similar success condition. The common valorization of mango stones, and that is in countries where they have large-scale production of mangoes, is to extract the oil and to use the remainder as an animal feed. However, smaller production countries don't have the extraction technologies available. They are not available at small scale, and the logistic chain does not exist. So there is a solution for that in this case, and that is to find an existing company that has a technology that is compatible with the technology that you are looking for your mango stones. And actually, that exists in the production of shea butter. And to the lower right, you see a picture of the shea butter nuts and the butter itself. And if you have a company already extracting that, they extract the oil and they market the oil, it is more easy to also start processing mango stones, for instance. You avoid the investment of an extraction plant, and at small scale, this is feasible in that way. As a final example in this whole list of examples, short examples, I will give you one that did not fly. So you can see not everything works out for the best. But this was a very nice idea, and that was to use the side streams from chicory roots. You see a picture of that to the left. Chicory roots are a common biomass in Belgium and the Netherlands. And the roots after inulin extraction, they are used as feed and sometimes even only as fertilizer. And the considered alternative here was to use it as a food fiber in the same fashion as you did with the citrus peels, for instance. It would increase the added value, and there was a scan done for valorization options and even a study on how it would behave in food. But for this product, it didn't fly. And the reason for that was that it was a relatively new product. It was very different from the existing products. And they were expecting only a very small market volume. So it was too expensive and it was lacking economies of scale. And this was a pity because the idea was good. I now would like to take you through two somewhat older examples on protein side streams. They are from the established food industry, so big companies that have big money to spend. And in principle, these innovations were driven by an awareness on pollution, but in the end, they made a lot of money from them. So these are side streams from the established food industry. I will give you the example of whey, which is a side stream from cheese making, and I will start with the protein rich liquid from potatoes. These protein sources were previously at best regarded as feed or as pollutant to start with. So AVB is a large Dutch company that makes starch from potatoes, and previously their wastewater was discharged into the kennels. And at the beginning of the previous century, people said, yeah, water pollution, that's just part of industrialization. It's just the price we pay for prosperity. However, government and industry tried to end the water pollution, but the technology was not sufficiently developed in those days. I would like to show you a picture. It's in black and white, so it might be less easy to spot, but it's a canal picture. You can see a boat on the canal, and you can see a big black mess. And actually, that's a foam that's on top of the water, and that's the wastewater disposal of AVB, which gives a foam, as there's a lot of protein in there. And I have a quote from 2 centuries back, from a famous person, Antony Winkler-Prins, at least he's famous in the Netherlands. A nauseating stench rose from the canals. The watercourses were littered with dead fish floating on their backs because the water was so filthy that it had become useless for animals and humans alike. Even the pumps produced nothing but spoiled liquid. So there was obviously something to be done about that. But all previous attempts were not successful. But then, after World War II, there was a new driver for innovation, and that was the environmental awareness that increased, and that there was a new law in 1969, and that was based on the polluter pays principle. So they had to pay money if they wanted to keep polluting. They also at AVB got some financial aid for research, and they reorganized. And another important part is that they made a lot of technological progress. The traditional way to get these proteins is to have an acid, a heat, or another precipitation method where you get a very non-functional protein. But they developed a new mild process that is based on chromatography. And with that, they get actually 3 different types of proteins. 2 of those are very native and have high value. So they set up a new company, Solenic. It's a spin-out of AVB. The driver for this was upgrading waste streams to a product, reducing the costs of waste, and the ambition in the end is to have a total valorization of the stream. One of the main success conditions for this was a new technology that worked. A very large drawback was the market development. I think the Solenic process is already 20 years old, but it took them quite some time to get their products to the market and to establish a market for these functional proteins. I think the fact that more and more products become vegetarian and vegan helped them. And then there's the whey example, from gutted to good. This is the example I referred to on my very first slide. Also here there are a few drivers for the historic development, and then environmental regulations and legislations were also an important part for starting to build a business case around whey. But also here, scientific and technological advances were needed to get to a good product with good functionality, both on the physical and on the nutritional part. They developed a process where you could concentrate and fractionate the whey while remaining a functionality. And one of the things that made it successful for them was that they could benefit from the functional foods revolution. And then this is the picture I showed you. You can see that in the 50s, whey was disposed of, and you can even see a negative value at those days. When they started developing it from gutter to good, they started developing whey powders, which didn't have a very high purity, but already made them roughly $1 a kilo. And then at a certain point of time, they transferred from good to gold, and this is when they start really purifying the whey protein concentrate. And you can see that if you are at a high purity, you can make even higher amounts than $10 per kilo, which is really nice for a waste product. And it's not the only thing the milk company makes money from, because it's, you can see it over here, it's the demineralized whey powder that they make money off, but they have a whole model of biorefining their milk, and they have a lot of products that they make from that, all making money. So concluding, these are protein sources which were not valued at all previously. The drivers were legislation, which became more strict, and in the end, they got approval by EFSA, and that's very important for all these new products. If you have EFSA approval and you are as fast as they were, you are one of the first to have vegetarian or plant-based proteins on the market. One of the key success factors is, of course, that they were big companies. They were very strong players in the value chain that they were already in. And that makes it a success. They could invest a lot of money. Nowadays, many people start to think from scratch. And I gave duckweed as an example, but they start from a whole new crop, a whole new situation where there is no value chain in place. And so it's much more difficult to start up biorefinery there. And in these types of cases, it's very important to establish a first product, a complete first product, for instance, duckweed as a feed, before you start developing products from it, so proteins from it or fibers from it. And then the last example where we have some food to food conversion is the Surplus Food Factory. It started a few years ago to reduce food waste, especially in catering, because in catering a lot of residues are created, for instance the sliced off parts of tomatoes where you don't want the start and the end of the tomato. And these are all collected already at one certain location, because that's where they were originally cut. And they actually produced soups and sauces from that, and they marketed them as sustainable food products. I even could buy that at my own supermarket. And one of the success factors there is that they work on social employment and they have people working there who have a distant relationship to the mainstream labor force. They are still going strong, but commercially it's still challenging and their products are quite expensive. And with that, I would like to switch from food to food to food to materials and chemicals, because of course you can also use food residues to create materials or chemicals from it. The first example that I would like to start with is a residue from chocolate production. Cocoa bean shells are a waste product from chocolate production that are normally at best incinerated for use as heat. But the circular carbon company made a pyrolysis process for it. They make biochar via pyrolysis, and the cocoa shells are ideal for this purpose. In a first project in Hamburg, they used 10,000 tons of shells in a year, and so far they generated 20 gigawatt hours of steam. The steam can in turn be used in the chocolate production, thus preventing a lot of CO2 emissions they would have otherwise had. The biochar they make acts as a sponge, and it has a depot effect for a healthy supply of nutrients and water to roots and microorganisms, for instance, in the soil. It can take up a huge amount of water, 5 times its weight. It can also be used again to for energy use, to improve gas yields in biogas plants, and it can even be used to improve the health of animals in farms when it's ingested. Bio-based products can also be made via fermentations, and I give you 3 examples of these on the current slide and another one on the next slide. The first one is fuel from seaweed. This was done in the macrofuels project, where they harvested huge amounts, 10 tons of seaweed in Scotland, and they did a lot of research on that. And in the end of the project, they derived 20 liters of seaweed-based fuel compounds from that, and a test car actually drove 80 kilometers with it for a proof of concept. Another project made even biojet fuels. There was a project with, amongst other companies, Sky Energy and Lamb Weston. Lamb Weston provided the potato peels from which, via an anaerobic fermentation, acetone, isopropanol, butanol and ethanol was made. The final example on this slide is the PHA production of the organic fraction of household waste. There's a lot of municipal solid waste being made, roughly 500 kilograms per person per year. So it's an important waste stream. And in this project, they wanted it to convert it into more valuable products than just compost or biogas. And they aimed at making chemical building blocks, amongst others bioethanol and fatty acids, but they also made biopolymers like PHA. PHA, polyhydroxyalkylonoate, can also be made from, for instance, frying oil. An example of that is in Czechia. Through use of the Heidel technology, Czech researchers and Navigate, a small company, used fermentation to produce PHAs. An example of that is the polyhydroxybutyrate production, PHB, that they made, and they are using that now in, for instance, coconut peeling milk. The PHB is biodegradable in water, and here they use it as peeling particles, but it can also be used as a UV filter. Moving away from fermentations again, I give you 2 examples where they use residues from bio oil production. The first one is from Andalusia. The company is called Bio Oils, and their main product is biodiesel. However, they also have other products which they market. They market, for instance, the pastes and gums that are a side product. They serve as an element in production of soaps and detergents. They have fatty acids as a side stream. And of course, they can be a raw material for the biodiesel process itself in the esterification. And they have glycerin, which contains mainly glycerol and can be used as a feed. The unique thing of their process is that the basic raw material for the whole process are vegetable oils and animal fats. The second example of the use of bio-oil residues is in the olive oil industry. Olive oil industry in the Mediterranean is very, very big and also produces a lot of byproducts. These byproducts include olive pomace, olive stones and olive leaves, and there's only limited outlets until recently. Trials, for instance, to use the destoned pomace for feed, they show issues with digestibility and palatability. So that's not a straightforward application. But the residues contain high-value compounds like polyphenols, hydroxyterosol and triterpenes. And these can be extracted through conventional extraction technologies and then applied in food, pharma and nutraceuticals. The final example I want to give to you is the black soldier fly larvae. The black soldier flies can be grown on side streams, feed, but outside Europe it can sometimes also be grown on manure. And from this you can make many products like a protein, oil and fertilizers. The oil can be extracted for feed, but it can also be used for transportation fuel production. The skins of the worms, or actually of the larvae, can be used as fertilizer. These two products are, for instance, made by Bestico, a Dutch company. You can also use the black soldier fly for proteins. Very often then the larvae are used as a whole. They dry the larvae and then they use them for fish and pet food products. And then I'd like to end this session with a take-home message. We saw some inspiring examples on added value creation. And we moved from waste to feed and even to food and sometimes to gold in the products that were processed. There are five important success conditions that you can take home from this series, which are an important plus in the success of your business. For instance, if there is already an existing logistics in place for gathering of the biomass, so if the residues are already collected. Another success condition can be the existing processing facilities for similar products, like we saw in the avocado and olive oil case. Another example is an existing channel for the product sales. If you really have to develop a market, getting a product out there will be difficult. Also, the market size that is out there needs to fit the size of your residue. If, like in the inulin case with the chicory roots, you have a lot of chicory, then the product is there's too much product to go to the market. The most important thing, I think personally, is a very enthusiastic entrepreneur that will pull the whole procedure. And it's important to be able to take a loss at the startup phase. Starting up will take you a lot of money. You can get an investor, but it's easier if you are a very large company or if you can share equipment with other companies. I would like to thank you for your attention. The next session is at 11 o'clock. We will talk about sustainability in that session and give you examples on upcycling and complete biomass valorization. More examples on added food value will be presented in session 5 next week. But I would like to end with a bonus. We received a video from CIDAF. It's on bioactive compounds for food and pharmaceutical industry, and they are made from food industry byproducts, like for instance olive leaves, avocado and mango peels and seeds. I hope you enjoy the video and maybe you have some questions later on.
The Functional Food Research and Development Center, CDAF, is located in the Health Science and Technological Park of Granada in Spain. Its mission is to transmit and generate knowledge about functional food. To achieve this, it collaborates with agri-food companies and research centers to solve several issues derived from the food management in agri-food industries. The research developed in CDAF intends to achieve healthy bioactive compounds that are useful to food and pharmaceutical industries in the development of their products. This research allows to obtain products with high added value in the field of nutraceutical and cosmeceuticals. The fields developed by CDAF for the productive sector or for other RDI centers are divided into six areas. Identification of products or byproducts from natural origin that can be sources of bioactive ingredients. Analytical characterization of bioactive ingredient composition. The center has equipment that includes, among others, advanced separative techniques such as liquid and gas chromatography coupled to high-resolution mass spectrometry. Extraction, drying, and isolation of functional ingredients using a wide variety of techniques such as preparative chromatography, pressurized liquid extraction, subcritical water extraction, supercritical fluid extraction, microwave-assisted extraction, lyophilization, fluid bed drying, and spray drying. Evaluation of bioactivity, safety, and mechanism of action of functional food through different in vitro or in vivo tests. CDAF has developed several projects in collaboration with other companies and public centers about the revalorization of byproducts derived from agri-food industries. Some of these are olive leaves coming from the harvest, as well as avocado and mango peels and seeds from the production of different food products. The main aim of this project is the search of bioactive compounds that include several steps. The extraction and isolation from the natural source. Its analytical characterization, the evaluation of its antioxidant, anti-inflammatory or antimicrobial activity, the encapsulation to achieve a controlled release, and finally, the incorporation in different food and chromatical matrices. This project intends to achieve a circular bioeconomy, reducing the environmental impact that results from the production of food and increasing the economical utilization of sources, giving high added value product which might promote the human health. Moreover, CDAF facilities count on a pilot plant that has 600 square meters, equipped with a clean room and the most advanced technological equipment for the formulation, elaboration and processing of functional foods. This pilot plant allows a scale-up of the optimized laboratory condition to upper industrial scale, providing small batches to test the product prior its commercialization. CDAF contribute to promote and boost the competitiveness of the agri-food industry in our country through the innovation and technological development, transferring the knowledge, scientific research, and the experience of each research and technician to obtain new food and nutritional supplements. Come to CDAF and work with us.